passion for you, a humbleness in our heart, knowing that without you, we have no hope. So Father, I lift this up to you, Lord. I ask you to bless it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. We're going to go into a time of offering right now before we start, because we're going to be ending with communion. So if you're new with us, our buckets are on the left-hand side along the rows. When you get settled in, if you want to pass those off and give our gifts and offerings to the Lord. Thanks for giving this morning. How are we doing? Hey, it's awesome to see the balcony getting filled. Praise God. That is awesome. Praise God. Well, hey, my name is Pastor John Lawley. I'm the pastor of students here, and it's a privilege to teach the Word of God to you this morning. It truly is. If you could turn your Bibles, or if you have your Bibles, we are people of the book. We encourage you to bring them. If you don't have one, in the back of our auditorium are Bibles that we want to give to you. They're our gift to you. You can take them and give them to your friends, or take them and read them yourselves. But if you have your Bibles, please turn to Romans chapter 3, and we're going to be picking it up on verse 21 of Romans chapter 3. So everyone well rested? Yeah? So we're kind of not well rested, because when you have children, they don't understand the time delay thing. So they just get up the same time, so we're just up an hour early, unfortunately. But hopefully when they're teenagers, it's the opposite. We have to like wake them up. But well, as you're turning to Romans chapter 3, there's a story about Martin Luther during the Reformation, where he is in this place where it's in Rome, it's this church, and what's called the Holy Stairs, and Martin Luther is climbing these stairs, and what was happening at the time is people would climb these stairs, and they would say prayers, and they would give money with the hopes that as they climb these stairs, when they get to the top, their sins are forgiven, they're restored back into relationship with God. And so Martin Luther is on these stairs, and he's praying these prayers in hopes that somehow he can reconcile the fact that he is a sinner with this perfect God. And in the midst of climbing these stairs and praying these prayers, a verse in the Bible from Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 14 comes to his mind, and it says, "The just shall live by faith." And so Martin Luther stops climbing these stairs on his knees. He stands up, he turns around, he walks down the stairs, and the Reformation begins. And it was in that time that Martin Luther had this realization that he was trying to earn favor with God. He was trying to do things in his life so that God would be pleased, so that he would earn salvation. And Martin Luther, as he read the Word of God, which as I talked about a couple weeks back, and Pastor Lee has done an amazing job on, the Word of God wasn't accessible to people. So he was one of the few that were actually reading the Word of God. And as he read the Word of God, he realized that what he was doing was not truth, that this book teaches a very different story, a very different worldview than what he was doing. And so he turned and he pursued faith and trust and some of these pillars of salvation. So in our Sola series, we've been diving into some of these theological kind of huge points. And we talked a little bit about the sufficiency of Scripture, Sola Scripture, that the Word of God is our source for truth. And we talked about grace, Sola Grace, that grace is given from God, and Sola Faith, that faith alone is what allows us to have right standing, faith in Jesus Christ. And so this morning, I'm going to talk about Christ alone, Sola Christ. This idea that, why do we place our hope and our foundation on the blood of Jesus? Why is this so key to our salvation and our faith? But to do that, I want to kind of lay the groundwork with this, just this idea that I've been seeing a lot in our world. And the idea is this, that when you interact with people, they come at you with very different worldviews, but I kind of sum them into two. One is, the Bible talks about, Paul talks about this idea of the mindset of the flesh. So this worldly mindset, which is simply this, that this world around you, everything you see and you touch and you experience, is geared and filtered through your desires, your wants, your needs, what's just to you, what's right to you. And so you look at this world and you even look at God and you say this, you say, how does God fit into what I think is good, what I think is right? And some of you are like, well, I don't know if I believe that, but I think even those that follow Jesus, we have a tendency to have this kind of framework. So for example, if something would go wrong in this world, a lot of times what we would do is we'd say, why would God let that happen? Or if God is a loving God, how could he do this? And by doing that, what we're doing is we're saying, okay, we understand justice, we understand righteousness, and God is not fitting into what we understand it to be. So what we're doing is we're saying, okay, even God has to fit into this worldview that it's about my want, my interest, my needs. And then there's this biblical worldview that we read in Scripture that says nothing of the sort. It says this, it says God's wants, God's needs, God's interest, his will, not mine. It's about him. It's not about me. It's about his glory, not about my glory. And listen, in order for you to understand Christ alone this morning, I promise you have to understand this. You cannot come at this passage with a selfish, worldly worldview. You can't, because you will not understand this. This will seem foolish to you. But if you have the biblical worldview, if you realize who you are and who God is, this is your only hope. So we're to dive at this Christ alone with the realization that it is God's will, God's plan. It is for his glory. And we are created by him for him. Are you following me? This is key. This changed my life as a young man. When I recognized that everything I was doing, every question I was asking about God was coming through the lens of me being God. So I did not acknowledge that there could be a God, but I thought, this God has to fit my kingdom and my will. And because of that, I was kept from knowing the real God and knowing the real me. This is something that we're afraid of, but I need to say this. If you do not recognize your own depravity, you will never worship Christ. If you do not recognize your own depravity, you will not worship Christ. This is our problem. Listen, we feel like we deserve it. We feel like his death on the cross was deserved. And because of that, we come in here worshiping a God that gives us something that we deserve, not a God who gives us something that which we don't. Are you following me? We do not deserve the mercy and grace of God. This is why we worship, because it's given to us as a gift. So let's dive into the word together. Romans chapter 3, verse 21. Says this, but now the righteousness of God has been manifested apart from the law, though the law and the prophets bear witness to it. The righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe. For there is no distinction, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God and are justified by his grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a propitiation by his blood, to be received by faith. This was to show God's righteousness, because in his divine forbearance he passed over former sins. It was to show his righteousness at the present time, so that he might be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus Christ. And so what I'm going to do this morning is I'm going to just simply go through these passages verse by verse. I'm going to pull out these truths that we need to embrace and receive as a church, as a body of Christ. And so as you first look in Romans chapter 3, verse 21, Paul is changing the argument here. So for the first three books of Romans, Paul is arguing with the Judaizers and the people that are trying to make the church believe that it is faith plus works, or Christ plus these things. And so what they were teaching was, yes, it's Jesus, but it's also the law. It's faith, but it's also the Jewish customs and religions of the day. It's trust in God, but it's circumcision. What they were doing is they were adding to these things. And so Paul is taking the law. He's taking how God has interacted with man through the course of human history, and he's highlighting these things to bring out the fact that, listen, it's always been by grace. It's always been by faith. And so Paul is arguing these things, and then he turns it to Jesus. He says, but now. And so he's bringing in light of, okay, here's how it worked. Here's how God received man. Here's how God related to man. But now, because of Jesus, this is what changes. This is how we are to look at the gospel moving forward. He says, because of the cross, this is what's happening. So he's setting the tone here by saying, but now. And then he goes on to say, the righteousness of God has been manifested apart from the law. Paul is talking about the idea of how can you be in right standing before God? How can you stand before a perfect God and him not being able to punish you for being imperfect? How does it look to be right before God? Is it by these laws that we have in the Old Testament? So Paul's bringing out the law, right? Moses, Mount Sinai, the Ten Commandments. Is it these things? If we do those things, are we in right standing before God? And Paul is saying, no, listen, the righteousness of God, to be in right standing with God, is not attached to the law. They are separate. And Pastor Lee did a great job last week of talking about how the law was actually never meant to be achieved by mankind. It wasn't that this is a standard in which mankind can accomplish. It was actually set in motion so that we would recognize that we cannot achieve those things. That the law is to reveal the fact that we are not enough. That no matter how hard we try, we fail to live up to the law, which makes us not righteous before God. So Paul is saying, listen, there is this righteousness of God that is coming upon man, and it came separate from man achieving these laws, separate from a man living a life without sin and being perfect, because no man has ever done that. He's setting the stage for Christ. He's saying, listen, outside of Christ, you cannot look, even in the highest of high in the Jewish tradition, you cannot find a person that has achieved perfection. We have all fallen short. So Paul is setting the stage by doing what? He's saying, you have to recognize that you are not enough. Church, this morning, this is key, especially for those who walk in here and are trying out this church thing and don't know a lot about Jesus but want to learn about Jesus. Here's the best advice I can give you. In order to understand the love of God, you must recognize, look at your life, look at the past, how you tried to obtain happiness, how you tried to be good, and did you succeed in that or did you fail? Were you good enough as a God in your life? Did you make a good God? I always say this to our students, you make a horrible God. I make a horrible God. When I try to do things to make myself good enough, I fail. And so Paul is setting the standard by saying, listen, this right standing of God is not attached to the law. That the law reveals the need for Jesus. But it doesn't make you have to earn favor with God in a separate way. It just reveals your need for something more. So I want to stop here and give us an example of how we do this often. And we're like, okay, that makes sense. I get this understanding that we need God. But in our lives, as we apply this, here's why we live in a way that oftentimes rejects what Paul is saying here. Is we say, we don't need God. What we need is to be better than the next person. Think about it. We say, if we're better than the next person, well, then God is going to love me and not them. That's the reason that we don't look at the standard of goodness and say, okay, the standard of goodness is something that we can't achieve. We say, no, that's, we can't praise each other if we look at it that way. So what we need to do is we need to say, well, I'm better than the person next to me, so then I'm good. Think about it. So you look at your life and you say, how do you measure if you're good or not? Do you measure it based on God's standard? Do you measure it based on the standard of the world? Well, I'm not in prison. I've never been arrested. Because in the Bible is going to reveal this, and Paul's going to talk about this. Listen, you're arguing this standard of good. I've prayed this many times. I've gone to the church this many times. And Paul says, but when you hear Jesus talk, Jesus actually ups the standard of goodness. He says, you think that there's a standard of goodness that has to do with your moral behavior. Jesus says, if you think it in your mind, you've committed it in your heart. So not only does Jesus talk about, listen, goodness isn't just what you do, but it's what you think. What is Paul doing? He's just trying to make sure that everyone recognizes their need. In the scriptures, it talks a lot about this idea of really the Old Testament prophets bearing witness to it. And what does that mean? It means that when you look at the Old Testament and you see how God interacts with man, how many of you have ever read the book of Exodus and were like, why do you guys keep on worshiping false gods? Do you know what I mean? Like you just saw water part and you walked through dry land. You just saw the power of God and then you're worshiping a statue. What's wrong with you? That's what I think. And then you know what I also think? I probably would have done the same thing. Because we are quick to forget the glory and the grace and the power of God. And we are so quick, church, listen, to worship the created and not the creator. So Paul is bringing these standards to light. And in verse 23, he talks about this idea that and I'm just going to reread it. It says, "For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God." And what he's saying there is that you have to understand what sin is. Sin is anything you do and anything you choose that does not bring God glory, anything. Now, I want you to think about this morning, church. Look at your week. Did everything in your week bring glory to God? Because if it didn't, here's the truth, then you deserve God's wrath, not God's mercy. Because he is a just God who created you to worship him. So you are a creation that is failing to do what you're created to do. Think about this. We always come at this idea of the gospel through our lens. Come at it through God's lens. That he who is all-powerful, all-knowing, creates a being who is designed to worship him, and the being rebels against God. The question is not, why does God allow wrath upon his people? It's, how does God rely on and have mercy on his creation? That as we reject giving him praise, he is patient with us. This is the fascinating thing. As we study the word, and I brought this up in my small groups a couple weeks ago, we study the word, especially in the Old Testament, and we see the justice of God, and we say, that doesn't make sense. Why would God bear wrath upon creation? But when we see in Scripture, there are several times in which God looks upon the world and he says, there's no one righteous, not even one. What does that say, church? That says that we think too highly of ourselves. That I believe that when God says that, he was right. That human beings have a capability of becoming so wicked that righteousness fails to be in existence. I was talking to a friend of mine the other day, and I said, you know what's fascinating about sin in the world? And we can look at this from the history of the beginning of time, is when sin manifests and sin grows and societies become wealthy and sin continues to grow and sexuality and all these things become manipulated and perverted. You know who's the first to suffer in a society? Women and children. Women and children suffer first. And so, church, as I look at a story like Sodom and Gomorrah, and a lot of us in our worldly mindset says, how could God destroy all of those people? My argument is one, I bet you there wasn't many children and women left. That human beings, apart from the righteousness of God, are left to sin and hopelessness and depravity. This is the biblical worldview that we need to see. Now listen, we don't live there as believers. We don't have to. But in order to worship the cross, in order to understand what Christ alone means, we have to understand who we would be without him. As we look and continue to look in these verses, in verse 24 it says that we are justified by his grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. That we are justified. We are no longer guilty before God because of Jesus. This is huge. Because you know what that says? It says you are guilty without him. Listen to me. That God could send us all in this room to hell and be completely just in doing so. So without Christ, we deserve this. So what justification means is that we are no longer guilty because of Jesus. We worship Christ because without him, we stand before a perfect God as imperfect, sinful, rebellion created beings that have no excuse for our rebellion and deserve the wrath. But God steps in through Christ. My goal here is not to make you feel less, but to make Christ feel more. Am I doing this? Am I making him matter? He is not just this person that we think did good things and taught good things. He's our Savior. You must understand your need for Savior and salvation in order to worship a Savior. You must understand the fact that you stand guilty before God without Christ. And then he says this, and he goes on and talks. I want you to understand what this Christ alone, what God did in his grace, because we talk about grace a lot. And I just remember this story. I was probably 22 and I was in this Bible study, and this guy told me a story, and it was based on a movie. I'm not going to tell you the movie, it's irrelevant, but in this movie, in this theater production show, there's this priest, and he has his silverware stolen by this thief, and this thief takes the silverware, and he gets captured, and he comes back to this priest, and the captors, the guards say, "Did this man steal your stuff? Did he steal your silverware?" And the priest goes over, he grabs the bag of the silverware left, and he brings it over to the thief, and he gives it all to him. And he says, "You forgot this." So the guards leave, and he basically says to the thief, "This is your second chance. You are no longer going to steal. You are no longer going to be a thief. I have rescued you from your life that you were leading." And so the point of this is simply this: mercy and justice. Justice would have been, this man stole my silverware. He deserves prison. That's justice. Mercy is, this man stole my silverware, but I forgive him. Grace was, this man stole my silverware, but I'm blessing him with more. I'm pulling him out of the life and the actions that he could not get out of. I'm rescuing him from a life that he cannot leave, and I'm placing him on a path that only I could have done. This is what the grace of God means. It means in our hopeless state, God doesn't just forgive us, he pulls us out of hopelessness and places us in the hope of Christ. This is what grace is. Grace is not just a forgiveness, it is a gift undeserved. And so in the passage in verse 25, Paul continues and he talks about, and this is huge, I want to live here for a little while. Paul in verse 25, I think as I was studying this verse, it just rocked me, just to be honest with you, church. I had a tough time planning my message after this, because I was just on my knees thinking, "Father, I've never thought about it like this. Thank you for letting me see this through your eyes." Here's what it says in verse 25: "Whom God put forward as a propitiation by his blood, to be received by faith." This is verse 25. "This was to show God's righteousness, because in his divine forbearance he had passed over former sins." Oh, we can't lose this. Imagine a king. Imagine somebody attempting to murder the king. Okay? And the person who's attempting to murder the king is captive. He gets captured, and the people who capture him slap him on the wrist and say, "Don't you ever do that again, let him go." Church, what would that say about the king? What would it say about his majesty, his glory, his reign, his might, his worth? It would say that the people don't value the king, if that's the appropriate consequences for attempted murder. What Paul is saying here, and the reason I explain it like that, is the word propitiation. It doesn't just mean this idea of wiping away sins, but it does. It means that it is a satisfied appeasement of God's wrath. So I want to bring this to light. What it means is when you ask the question, and I guarantee most of you walking in this room didn't ask this question when you came in, because we are worldly in our mindset often. But the question of, how does a loving God have his creation sin against him and he just passes over it? How does that make any sense? What does that say about God? That he could see a David and his sin against Bathsheba. And what does God say there? He says, "Why have you despised me?" that as human beings, as we sin against God, we're demoting his glory. We're saying you are less because we are choosing to worship something more than you. So this is against the very nature and character of God. And so why would he pass over that? Why would a God allow his creation to sin against him? This is what Paul is saying. He's saying God sees the rebellion and he didn't act upon it because he saw the cross. He saw Christ. And that the cross is not just an act of love towards you, it is also justice. It is God's wrath upon the creation being met in Christ. Are you following this? That God showed us mercy because he saw his son. How many of you have ever read and thought, why didn't God just burn everyone up? There are times when Jesus is on the cross. He's on the cross and people are mocking him. If I was God, why the grace? Why not show them the power that they're making fun of you? Reveal it. He knew. He knew. And this is what he knew, church, and listen to me, that his wrath, his just wrath that was justly able to be placed upon man, he placed upon his son. That the wrath that we deserved, that he passed over, he placed upon his son. This is the amazing thing about the cross. That our forgiveness without Christ is a threat to the righteousness of God. This is what Paul is saying here when he talks about passing over former sins. This is amazing because this is not coming from a posture of, God, we deserve this. This is why we don't worship, because we think we do. And Paul is simply saying, listen, have you ever asked the question of why does God continue to forgive you? It's because of the cross. It's because of the price paid so that you no longer have to live condemned. That's why we talk about this, I see, as believers. When we wrestle, when we sin, and we fall short of the glory of God, we wrestle with the idea of not being good enough, that God can't love us because of what we've done. But the cross shows that God does. The cross shows that God forgave us, even the sins that we are to commit tomorrow, that the cross shows that God passes over those sins because of what Christ did, that Christ absorbs all these sins. This is powerful. This is powerful. Verse 26 says this. It is to show his righteousness. Paul says this is why he passes over things that he should justly bring wrath to. This is why he allowed these things in the Old Testament and in the New Testament to happen. He says, because the righteousness of God at this present time, that he might be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus Christ. So we look at the Old Testament and we see these people in the Old Testament and we become the standard and we say, God, they deserve punishment, but they don't deserve punishment. And we try to set these standards, say, God, you should look at human beings differently. You should look at some good and some not good. And we try to elevate standards, which is how the church becomes a works-based thing. We say, you have to earn favor with God. And we do that by saying that some people are closer to favor than other people. And we eliminate Jesus in that equation. And we just place works into it. We say things like this. I know a lot of us, I've said it. Hitler deserves hell. These people who have done bad things deserve hell, but I don't. What are we doing there? We're placing a standard of goodness before God and saying, you operate in this standard. God doesn't. The grace and mercy and gifts of God are given to men in which no one deserves. This is the standard in which we are to approach it. Which means if we are judging somebody, listen to me, church, if we're judging somebody based on their sin without offering hope, what are we doing? Because if I am in need of a Savior, because I myself am a sinner who has a prone to sin, prone to worship the created over the creation of the Creator, if that's who I am, then I am to look at the world through that same lens of, listen, Christ is our hope. Christ is my hope. Christ is your hope. And the standard in which we are to see Christ, all of us, is we are undeserving, but yet his righteousness is imputed, is given to us without us earning it, but by receiving it. Rather than vindicating his glory by slaying his people, he vindicated his glory by slaying his son. This is what it means when we talk about the cross being both the justice and the love of God being met. Do you feel that this morning? Is that something you've anchored your faith on? Listen, I know this doesn't sound happy, but this is the best message ever. Like, I know that coming in here and hearing about your depravity is not woohoo. I know that. But what hope am I presenting to you? It's amazing. This is amazing. This is the best message and hope that you will ever hear in your life. That this book tells the truth about you. You ever think about that? This tells the truth about you. It doesn't say that you're good and that when you're alone and no one's there that you just think good things. If it would say that, how lost would you feel? That even the God of the universe doesn't understand you, that's how you'd feel. But in fact, the Bible doesn't say that, does it? It says, listen, I know your heart. I know what you think about. I know what you struggle with. The Bible says, I know that you're a sinner. And God says, while you were there, while you deserved my wrath and my justice, you are loved. That even in the midst of me falling short, I place my hope on Christ, who is the atonement, the justifier, that when I stand before God in judgment, that God will not see my imperfections and my sin. That he will see me through the blood of Jesus, and I will be delighted in. I will be embraced as a son. I have been adopted into the kingdom of God. That's how he sees me, because of Jesus, not because of me. So why do I not worship the creation? Why don't I worship the creation? It's because I see the creation for what it is. This is a struggle that we make even when we leave here. We're going to worship it. We're going to have this tendency to go back, just like in the Old Testament. Right now, I pray that the Spirit of God is hitting your hearts. I pray that right now you're thinking, okay, this is truth. It's not coming from me, it's coming from, that this is truth, that it is God's grace and mercy, and it's a cross that brings the only hope to mankind. Why? Because without the cross, where do we go? Where do we go? Do we go to achieving things in this world and then presenting that to a God even in the midst of our sins? What can we present before the Lord of any value outside of the cross? I'm serious about this. There's a song that I love by a writer, and he says this line. It just sticks with me. He says, all my love is vinegar before a thirsty king. The idea of we think that we can do things in order to say, okay, I don't need Jesus. I'm able to achieve right standing before God separate from that. For us to think that is for us to present a king something that he does not need. But if we are in Christ, we are new creations. We have been set apart. We have been born again. This is the language of the Bible. The Bible doesn't say, hey, you just need to change the way you think. It says you need to be born again. That it's a heart thing. That you are rebellious by nature. And that you need the grace of God. You need the Spirit of God to make you new. So in closing, I want to just leave with a couple thoughts here. I want us to really be filled with wonder about this stuff. Like, I want us to think about Jesus in a different way, because I can promise you, reading this passage and really meditating on the Word of God this week, I really feel like I have embraced the cross in just a different way. When we sing Christ alone in worship, it means something different. And listen, I've been saved for many years. I've been saved, but I neglect my worship of God in this way. I always think about Jesus dying on the cross, and I accept that. But for me, to think of myself as deserving of God's wrath, I have a hard time with that, because we live in this society, in this world, that pumps us up, right? Makes human beings higher than we ought to be. And we live in a world where we look at the gospel and we look at these things and we say, I deserve it. And because of that, we fail to truly worship. So when Martin Luther is climbing those stairs, he did not leave those stairs thinking that he was better than the people on the stairs. This is important to understand. The Reformation wasn't birthed out of wanting people to feel bad or wanting the church to feel bad. The Reformation was birthed out of reading God's word and responding to it. And listen, don't just believe me. Like, I want you to read this word, and I want you to read it through the lens of God's view. Like, what does God say about you? What does the Bible teach us about man? What does the Bible teach us about the character and nature of God? I talk to our students all the time. I say, when you read the Word of God, here's what I want you to do. As you read the Word of God, I want you to pull out these truths. What does it reveal about the nature and character of God? As you're reading, what does it say about God? And as you're reading, what does it say about you? What does it say about mankind? Like, you look at the world around you, church, and the world around you will say, the reason that human beings behave badly, this is so important for our day, listen, because the Bible just completely brings light to this. It said, the world says, the reason that human beings behave badly is because of the condition that they're in, because of the people around them, because how they were raised, just because what was tempted or what was done to them. This is the reason that people behave badly. What they're doing there, and again, this is the worldview of the flesh, they're saying people aren't bad. It's these things around them that make them bad. But you are born good, and the society makes you bad. You know what the Bible says? It doesn't say that. The Bible says that you are born sinful. That the culture and the conditions and the environment around you helped you become more depraved. But you are a sinner. You were born sinful. I have three daughters, and I say this all the time. We didn't teach them to sin. We didn't teach them to be selfish. They were selfish. I love them, but every one of my daughters filters this world through my wants, my needs. Am I wrong, parents? It's my bottle. It's my toy. We look at the world, and we are born to look at the world and consume it. This is what we were born into. And if this is true, then when we look at the depravity of man, we can't say, well, we're only depraved because of what others did. We have to say, we are sinful. We need a savior. That it's not through culture. It's not through environment. It is something more that makes us this way, and our only hope is Christ. So when I hear my brothers and sisters in Christ try to blame their badness on somebody other than themselves, I'm quick to say, listen, recognize your own depravity. Bring it to the throne. Bring it to the cross. And say, Father, I need you. I need you to change me. So when I talk about Christ alone to the world will see this message of, so you're saying there's this man who lived a long time ago who died on a cross for me? Why would he have to die for me? I'm awesome. I've had those conversations with the teenagers. I have. Why does God have to die for me? I don't need him to die for me. You know what I do at that moment? I say, God, let them see themselves the way they are. Again, church, if you don't see yourselves as a sinner, you're never going to see your need for the Savior. And that your sin is not based on culture. And so this is our hope. This is why mankind has to come to realize that Christ is the only way. That's why a statement when Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. He's not making an inclusive claim to say that all these other religions are wrong. He's saying, listen, there's a problem that every religion is trying to solve, which is you are trying to earn favor with God. You are trying to do something in order for God to not see you as sinful. Here's the problem, you are. So when you follow a religion that says, listen, you need to do these things, you need to be perfect for God to love you, how helpless are you when even though you pretend to be perfect, you know you're not? This is the problem that every religion, every people group in this world is trying to chase. How do we become right with God? Is it by praying a certain amount of times? Is it by acting a certain amount of times? And what no one recognizes is our nature, except for the scriptures. This is why I know it's truth. This is why I anchor my life on it. Because our faith is the only faith that tells the truth about who we are. And our faith is the only one that presents the hope apart from us. That I know I'm not good enough. But I know that Christ lived a perfect life. That he atoned. That the perfection that was needed to restore us back to God, Christ fulfilled. And on the cross, all of the sins that I had no ability to overcome was placed upon the cross. Now I am on right standing before the Lord. And that's why I worship Christ. That's why I worship Christ alone. Do you understand that, church? Okay, I'm going to ask the band to come up. And I'm going to pray. And I'm going to simply pray that our worldview begins to move from, Father, I deserve, to Father, thank you. Like, Father, I deserve the cross. The Father, I don't, but yet you've given me a way. I'm so humbled by you, Father. I want us to have a posture of worship, because if we don't, we will never truly receive this. We just won't. And so coming out of this, I think this is why this is perfect, is we're going to be coming into a time of communion. And to be honest with you, I'm like you in that sometimes communion just becomes just what we do, right? It just becomes a pattern. And it's that way because we don't, what's the value of remembering Christ? Well, this is the value. It's to take our minds, this is why Jesus says, do this in remembrance of me. It's to take our minds from us and place it on God. It's to remind us that we are sinners, and it reminds us of the sacrifice that had to be made, that unjustly, when we as created beings do not worship the created God, that punishment, that God saw that punishment as so great that he had to have his son die. Like, he sees sins as a big deal. That, listen, that the rebellion against God, the just punishment, is eternity in hell. One more example. We see that and we say, well, that doesn't seem fair, that eternity in hell for rebellion against God. So this is the truth. Either we don't recognize what sin is. If God is perfect and he says, this is the just punishment, then if we have a problem with that, we devalue God. But if we see that as saying just, that is just, then we make a big God. And we make a powerful Christ. That he rescues us in our rebellion from eternity of separation. That's where our hope is found, church. It's not found in man. It's found in the blood of Jesus. And so with that being said, I'm going to open us up with communion. I'm going to ask that you come forward and pass. And so if you are new with us, there will be two cups. Take them both. And we're going to kind of sing this song. We're going to really meditate on this truth. And I'm going to come up and lead us in the communion. But I want you to have a time here where it's not me talking. It's you worshiping. So as you grab your cups, spend time in this truth. Spend time before God, not asking him for something, but worshiping him for what he's done for you. Spending time in gratitude. Amen. I love you guys. Do communion if you want to pull out the cup with the bread. The body of Christ is what's represented when we take of this. And Jesus talks about the idea of us remembering him, remembering what he did on the cross by taking part in this. And here's what I want us to do. I'm not going to talk a lot because it's not about me. What I want you to do is I want you to look at this and remember that God's wrath, his justice and love met on the cross. And that this doesn't just represent your salvation, but this represents your atonement, your justification, the propitiation of Christ. This represents so much of how we are to partake this, not because we are to remember, but we are to live in this hope. So Jesus says, do this in remembrance of me, how God's love bore the wrath of our sins. Church, you may partake. Thank you, Jesus. So Jesus takes the cup and he says the same. He says, listen, this is my blood, and it was poured out for you. And that it was a remember. See, when we talk about the cross, we have to remember the old covenant. We have to remember how there was sacrifice that was needed in order to have sins forgiven. And Jesus didn't look at that sacrifice and see the sacrifice as the true forgiveness. Remember, he was thinking about Christ, which is why he was able to pass over. But he saw the sacrifice and he established a sacrificial system so that when Jesus came and he died, his blood would represent something that for years and years and years they were hoping and placing on these lambs, on these sheep. And so this blood is representing of the blood poured out for our sins. That it was the blood that absorbed all of the penalties, all of the wrath of God, all of the just sin that we have committed against God. All of that, the justice of God is absorbed by the cross of Christ. And so this blood, again, represents more than just our salvation. It represents the justice of God. And for that, we are to remember it. Church, you may partake. Thank you, Jesus. Father, thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Father, I pray right now that you would awaken your church to worship you, to be in reverence of you. Father, forgive us for making it about us. Father, help us to put on the lens in which you see the world. We thank you for your mercies every day and your grace every day. Lord, that in a world that continues to rebel against you, Lord, you've given us breath and friendships and laughter and sunlight and flowers and be able to witness your creation even in our rebellion. Lord, that's because of Jesus. So, Father, we thank you again. Help us as we close in this worship, Lord. Help us to worship like we've never done. Because we truly understand Christ. And because of that, we worship unashamed. Because you are our hope. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 Well, church, we rejoice in this promise and this truth. I'm going to change gears a little bit. I have a little piece of paper so I can remember all of it. But a couple announcements for you as you leave here, praising God in joy and hope because of the cross. couple announcements. We are right now in our Operation Christmas Child mode as a church. We do an amazing job. We have amazing leadership with this ministry. A couple things to note. A packing party will be next Sunday after second service. And so if you want, as a family, you can come and help join us. There's a big kind of assembly line, and we just kind of pack all these boxes and send them off. And so come. It's a great time to be in community with your church, as well as to serve in this ministry. Also, there are signups, so let us know, because we want to know how many to make lunch and make sure you have food provided for you. We are in need, though. We have some shortages still. Soap, washcloths, pencils, and crayons. So again, soap, washcloths, pencils, and crayons. We're short on those, so if you wanted to run out and grab some of those this week and drop them off, it would be greatly appreciated. And we also today are collecting money to ship out as well, because the boxes are cost money to ship out, and so we also raise money to send those out. So if you want to partner with us, just come see one of our Operation Christmas Child before you leave, and they'll make sure to answer any questions you may have. Let me pray us off. Father, we love you, and Lord, we thank you for Christ. We thank you that you died on the cross for us, that you bore the justice and the love. And Lord, we thank you that we are set apart because of that, Father. We thank you for Martin Luther and the Reformers setting in motion a dependency on your word and your truth, that is through faith, Lord, alone, that we are saved. So Lord, we place our faith in the cross. We place our faith in Christ. And Lord, what you've done. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you guys. Have a great morning.